Today, we'll start with Chapter 2 of History, The Establishment of Company Power. Let's begin.
Namaste. I am Farmer. I belong to a country called India. It is a country in South of Asia. Do you know why I am here? The reason why I became so sick. What was the beautiful time when my country was called the Golden Bird? So, hear the story of my country that was once a golden bird. India had been a popular destination for trade since ancient times. Trade relations were with Europe, Africa, Middle East, and Southeast Asia. The trade relations were flourishing like anything. The demand of spices, textiles, indigo, muslin, silk, precious stones were high in European countries that were here in India. After the death of Mughal Emperor Aurangzeb, there was no central power in India. Attracted by enormous wealth and aware of the political instability, many European countries tried to dominate and acquire my country. Some amongst them were Portuguese, Dutch, English, and French. They came to India via sea route. They mastered my vast country by coming on my mainland and invading the rich resources. The first to come were Portuguese. Vasco da Gama found a sea route to India. He sailed his ship from Lisbon in Portugal to Cape of Good Hope in Africa and reached Calicut in Kerala. They firstly dominated Malabar coast, then Almora and Albuquerque, established trade settlements in Goa, Daman and Diu. Then next were Dutch. They came in 1602 and they were the people who came from Netherlands. It is a country in Europe. They were interested in Spice Islands in the Far East. Far East means Indonesia. They established many trade centers in my country at Surat, Bharuch, Nagapattinam, Cochin and Musalipattinam. In 1600, Queen Elizabeth I granted to East India Company charter to trade with Eastern countries. And the bad days of my country started when Jahangir granted Farman allowing to establish permanent factory. On my beautiful land, many factories were constructed, and worst thing that happened that kings and rulers granted permission to Sir Thomas Roy to open factories at Agra, Bharuch and Ahmedabad. Britishers were successful in their aim. They again got permission to establish fortified factories like Fort St. George at Madras, factories at Hooghly, Fort William in Bengal. Then, the last one in these European countries were French East India Company. They came in 1604, established themselves at Karaikal, Mahe, Chandranagore and Mauritius. Mauritius is a place an island in Indian Ocean. Then, they all devised a policy called mercantilism. According to this, gold stores a company held is to be increased by trading and exporting to other countries and by importing less. This was the time when my bad days were started. Many more people of India suffered, many lost their family members and many were died because of the rivalry, competition and constant battles among the four companies. These four came to India for trade. And there was a sense of competition that for that they become rivals. English defeated Portuguese and Dutch, but French was still there. French was still in India up to the end of 18th century. Wars often used to break out between these two countries. Their differences were finally resolved through the Three Carnatic Wars or Anglo-French Wars, fought from 1744 to 1763. First Carnatic War was because the threat to capture Pondicherry, a French settlement, by English fleet led Dupleix to capture Madras. And in this war, English defeated French. Then Second Carnatic War was fought over the issue of succession in the Carnatic and Hyderabad. That was perhaps the turning point in French's role in Indian history. Third Carnatic War. French lost all their position in Karnataka and were defeated in the Battle of Vandivash in 1760. The English realized the weakness of Indian rulers and their armies. They were to use these to their advantages in the coming years, and the result of these three wars was that French continued to trade under the protection of British. They were not allowed to keep their troops. After the Battle of Carnatic War between British and French, the next important battle was the Battle of Plassey. Plassey is a place in West Bengal. This battle was fought between the Nawab of Bengal, Siraj-ud-Daula, and the English East India Company in 1757. The basic reason was fortification done without seeking Nawab's permission. Then the important incident was Black Hole tragedy. After that, Robert Clive, with the help of Mir Zafar, captured and killed Siraj-ud-Daula, and this was the first major victory of the company in India. Mir Zafar was then replaced by Mir Qasim. Clive became Governor General of Bengal in 1758. Later on, Mir Qasim also emerged as a threat to the company because he granted the concessions that earlier only Britishers used to enjoy. Then important battle was Battle of Buxar. Buxar is a place in Bihar. This battle was fought in 1764 between the three alliances on one side, that is Nawab of Bengal, Mughal Emperor and Nawab of Awadh, and English on the other side. The allies were defeated by the company's forces at Buxar, and company became the real master of Bengal, Bihar and Odisha. Then Treaty of Allahabad was signed between them, and company got right to collect Diwani revenue. Right to nominate the deputy subedar was also in the hand of company. Then later on, the dual system was followed, that is, the dual system of administration. After conquering the richest province of Bengal and having eliminated all their foreign rivals, the company acquired entire subcontinent except Punjab and Sindh. After that, four Anglo-Mysore wars were fought between 1766 to 99. And it was led between Warren Hastings and the Nawab of Mysore, Haider Ali. After Haider Ali, the Tipu Sultan continued these wars, and he was killed fighting heroically in 1799. The Britishers were able to conquer because of the help of Nizam of Hyderabad and Marathas, and Tipu's territories were divided between British and their ally Nizam, and the new ruler signed the subsidiary treaty. The company fought three wars with Marathas, that were Anglo-Maratha wars. The Maratha chiefs, Holkers, Sindhias, Gaikwad and Bhosle signed the subsidiary treaty. Maratha sardars were not united and often some sided with the British to fight. Lord Hastings dethroned the Peshwa and removed him of his pension. Then I will tell you about subsidiary treaty. Lord Wellesley gave shape to a policy. According to this, the ruler who signed the subsidiary treaty accepted the permanent stationing of British forces in his kingdom at his cost, and the company would give protection in return. The Nizam, the Nawab of Awadh, the Marathas and the Rajputs were the major rulers who signed this treaty. During this Anglo-Maratha war, I lost my family members. I hope you can understand what would be my condition at that time, my pain, my agony and my sufferings. Britishers annexed Sindh by 1843, and after the death of Ranjit Singh, the King of Punjab, his kingdom submerged into instability, caused by a civil war between his wife Rani Jindin and the army, and taking this as an advantage, Britishers defeated Punjab by two wars. Thus, the last independent state was absorbed into the British Empire. Lord Dalhousie devised a policy called Doctrine of Lapse. In this, Indian ruler died without a male heir. His kingdom would lapse or pass into British hand. He also abolished the titles of rulers according to this doctrine. The company also took over Awadh by blaming the ruler Wajid Ali, who was Nawab of Awadh, of maladministration and misgovernance. And humiliated and angered by this, the people of Awadh joined the great protest that was broke out in 1857. But this revolt was successfully stopped by Britishers. British government should control the basic policies of the company's Indian administration, which had become highly corrupt. So number of acts were passed. First among them was the Regulating Act of 1773. In this, Council of Four members were appointed under the Governor General. And there was one limitation that Governor General could be overruled by his council. Then second one was Pitt's India Act. In this, British government established Board of Control and there were 6 commissioners and 2 cabinet ministers. In this, the work of Board of Directors and control of Governor General was defined clearly. After that was the Charter Act of 1786. In this, Governor General has right to overrule his council. Then Charter Act of 1813. In this, company's monopoly to trade in India was abolished and this was the best thing that could ever happen to India. Then was the Act of 1833. A law member was added to the Governor General Council. Now I will tell you about administrative organizations. Lord Cornwallis established the Indian Civil Services in India. It was started through an entrance examination that was held in England and later on it started in India. Indians were excluded from higher posts. It was the highest paid service in the world and the civil servants were generally hard working and efficient. Then the army. The company army was first raised during Carnatic Wars. The army consisted of British officers and Indian sepoys. Sepoys remained loyal to their masters. Then police. Lord Cornwallis established a regular police force in India to maintain law and order. District was divided into thanas and thana under a daroga. The district superintendent headed the district. The villages were looked after by chowkidars and towns were looked after by kotwals. Then judicial organization. The British codified the existing system of law. The Indian Penal Code, Code of Civil and Criminal Procedures came into existence in 1837. In 1774, Supreme Court was established at Calcutta. Then there was introduction of rule of law and equality before law. Europeans had separate court and the Governor General was confined all the law-making powers in 1833. East India Company was transformed from a trading company to a colonial power. About 63% of the territory and about 78% of the population of Indian subcontinent was conquered. Thus, East India Company had virtually the whole of India under its control. Now I hope you understood the black pages of history of India. The golden bird could not fly with the open wings anymore just because of these trading companies. My soul burns in fire when I remember those battles and all act of Governor Generals. How can one be so mean and selfish to fulfill European demand? Exploiting and dominating our territory. I am sick because I fought in the battle and survived by God's grace. For you children to know about the brutal treatment of so-called supreme power, Britain and Europe. Now I am sure you are able to connect this medieval period colonial rule with that of trade and business of China in India. China is also increasing its exports by making infinite profit. My dear young Indians, don't allow the rich Indian resources to get exported, as you are the bright future of my country. Thank you.
I hope all of you understood how East India Company came to India for trade and how it occupied all territories of India.